Okay, you can turn to Genesis 47. That's where our scripture reading will be from this morning as we continue our sermon series in the book of Genesis. For the last couple of weeks in this sermon series, we've been looking at the place that God prepared for his people in Egypt. It was the place that God had appointed for them to be at this time in their history, where he would take care of them. 2 weeks ago, we saw how the place God provided for his people in the time of Joseph was Egypt, of all places. God called them to go to Egypt and to dwell there, and he promised that he would sustain them in the famine, and also that there in Egypt, he would multiply them into a numerous people, into a great nation. I explained to you that in our day, the place that God has called us to go, where he nurtures us, where he cares for us, provides for us, is the church. Wherever it is that the ordinances of God are administered properly, that the word of God is preached faithfully, that discipline is exercised, these things, wherever in all places, in all different nations and cities where God has raised up his people, that's the place that we're to go and join ourselves to in order that we might receive his blessing. Every believer is called to unite to a true visible church where the word of God is preached and the care that Jesus appointed for his saints is provided. Now you see, the interesting thing is that in the time of Joseph, the place that they were to go was Egypt. Last week, I drew from Joseph's example to see what Christ provides for us in the place that he has called us to be. First, that we find Jesus to be a mediator who has all authority that warmly welcomes us into his house. And you remember how Joseph, when his brothers came and his father that he had not seen for so many years, how he welcomed him and greeted him. So the Lord Jesus Christ meets us. He comes to us to wash us and cleanse us at the door, to clothe us with righteousness and to welcome us in to dwell with him and his people. We have a brother who is reigning at the right hand of the majesty on high, who has authority to pull all the strings, to do whatever he wishes, and he is there welcoming us and caring for us. Secondly, we saw that this mediator provides a place for us that is exactly what is best for us. We saw that for Jacob's family, it was not the high places in Egypt, the honored places that Joseph could have given them. He could have made them officers in Pharaoh's court. He had all this authority to do whatever he wanted. And he did not do that, but rather appointed for them the land of Goshen, where they could live as humble shepherds. It was a place of great humility because the Egyptians looked with disdain upon shepherds and cowboys that took care of cattle and things like that. That was not something the Egyptians were into. We saw how Jesus often keeps us from exalted places in the world. Not because he is unable to give us those places. We sometimes say, well, why aren't Christians in these high places of authority where they could have more influence? Why doesn't the Lord raise us up? Because, like Joseph knew, it's not the best thing for us. What would have happened if they had been given high positions in Egypt? They would have mingled with the Egyptians. They would have become an indistinct people. They would have not been the nation that God called them to be, that was to bring forth the Messiah in the days to come, and that he would reveal through his prophets all the things that he was to do. So they were in this little place, Goshen. It was a good place for what they were doing, the best of the land for shepherding. And they were there provided for. And Joseph, in his wisdom, you see, did not give them those high places. And we saw that as we follow the Lord faithfully, there's a lot of things we can't do. You can't excel and become a professional football player, for example, because you have to transgress the Lord's day in order to do that. And you see that God, we shouldn't say, well, we need to do it anyway because we have to be in these places of influence. No, God has us where he wants us. If he wants us to be in places of influence, he will open up the way. And third, we saw that even though it may not look like it, that we have the best portion of all. You know, here is wrinkled up old Jacob. And he's there before Pharaoh, depending on Pharaoh for bread. His family was starving. And here he comes before Pharaoh, and what does he do? He blesses Pharaoh. The greater blesses the lesser. It was marvelous what we saw in that Jacob knew that he had the blessing that Pharaoh needed. Yes, Pharaoh had bread that Jacob needed, but Jacob had what Pharaoh needed even more. And he blessed him. And we're going to be looking at that a little bit more this morning. But I pointed out how marvelous that this was, because to the world, Pharaoh had everything. But when it came to the blessing of God's kingdom, it was Jacob who had everything. Now, as we move into today's sermon, I want you to consider how Pharaoh in Egypt was like a foster father for Jacob in his household, for Israel, as the family of Jacob was called. God raised up Pharaoh at this time to look after Israel, to provide for them while they grew into a great nation. And I took that title, foster father, from Isaiah chapter 49, verse 22 and 23, where the Lord prophesies there that in the times that we live in now, in the time after Christ came, that he would raise up foster fathers in his future kingdom. He speaks of the times in which we live, the times after Jesus has come, when the church is spreading into all the world. And you see, at that time in Isaiah's day, the people were rather discouraged because there were not many, the godly people were discouraged, because there weren't very many godly people in the church at that time. Isaiah was preaching and God told him, people aren't going to listen to you, and they didn't. So the godly people were discouraged by that. What's going to happen to us? Are we just going to kind of fizzle out and be of no account in the world, or what? But you see, God was promising to them that in the future, that kings would be looking after people from all different nations that had come to him. And he said, you're going to look and say, where did all these people come from? Where did all these sons and daughters come from all these different nations? There's people from all over the world that are calling on God's name. And of course, that's exactly what happened. We read here in Isaiah 49:22, it says, thus says the Lord God, behold, I will lift up my hand in an oath to the nations and set up my standard for the people. He's going to establish the gospel among the nations. They shall bring your sons in their arms, and your daughters shall be carried on their shoulders. Kings shall be your foster fathers, and their queens your nursing mothers. They shall bow down to you with their faces to the earth and lick up the dust of your feet. Then you will know that I am the Lord, for they shall not be ashamed who wait on me. And this is, you see, exactly what has happened in our day. The situation that Isaiah prophesies is what we have in the world today. A situation in which we are among the nations that have now come to Christ. We have our rulers, kings, queens, whatever they might call themselves. And they are looking after the church. God has placed them over us in various places. They're our foster fathers and our nursing mothers. Sometimes they're very friendly toward us. Sometimes they're even believers. Sometimes they're not very friendly at all. They regard us with disdain and they persecute us and exclude us. But they're always the ones that God has appointed to be our foster care parents until the time that Jesus Christ returns. That's how God looks. He uses them, you see, in his sovereign wisdom. He uses them to look after us. And that's what we're going to be looking at today in Genesis 47. How Israel, during the time that we're reading about in their history, long ago when Joseph was there, when they were brought under a foster father in Egypt, we want to gain wisdom by looking at that situation today, about our situation. We're going to learn from what's recorded in Genesis 47 about how we're supposed to respond to the foster fathers, the rulers of the world that God has put over us to care for us today. So I want to begin our scripture reading in Genesis 47:7. That overlaps a little bit with what we looked at last week. Pharaoh had welcomed Jacob. To give you the context, Pharaoh had welcomed Jacob and his family as they had just come to Egypt. He had authorized the giving of Goshen to them. So he was being a foster father, providing land for them, providing bread for them through the mediation of Joseph. And now they are settled there, and Jacob comes to meet Pharaoh. He's brought before Pharaoh, and that's where we pick up our reading with 47:7. Okay, please give reverent attention then, because this is God's word. Genesis 47:7. Then Joseph brought in his father Jacob and set him before Pharaoh, and Jacob blessed Pharaoh. Pharaoh said to Jacob, "How old are you?" And Jacob said to Pharaoh, "The days of the years of my pilgrimage are 130 years. Few and evil have been the days of the years of my life, and they have not attained to the days of the years of the life of my fathers in the days of their pilgrimage." So Jacob blessed Pharaoh and went out from before Pharaoh. And Joseph situated his father and his brothers and gave them a possession in the land of Egypt, in the best of the land, in the land of Ramesses, as Pharaoh had commanded. Then Joseph provided his father, his brothers, and all his father's household with bread according to the number in their families. Now there was no bread in all the land, for the famine was very severe, so that the land of Egypt and the land of Canaan languished because of the famine. And Joseph gathered up all the money that was found in the land of Egypt and in the land of Canaan for the grain which they bought. And Joseph brought the money into Pharaoh's house. So when the money failed in the land of Egypt and in the land of Canaan, all the Egyptians came to Joseph and said, "Give us bread, for why should we die in your presence? For the money has failed." Then Joseph said, "Give your livestock, and I will give you bread for your livestock if the money is gone." So they brought their livestock to Joseph, and Joseph gave them bread in exchange for the horses, the flocks, the cattle of the herds, and for the donkeys. Thus he fed them with bread in exchange for all their livestock that year. When that year had ended, they came to him the next year and said to him, "We will not hide from my lord that our money is gone. My lord also has our herds of livestock. There is nothing left in the sight of my lord but our bodies and our lands. Why should we die before your eyes, both we and our land? Buy us and our land for bread, and we and our land will be servants of Pharaoh. Give us seed that we may live and not die, that the land may not be desolate." And Joseph bought all the land of Egypt for Pharaoh. For every man of the Egyptians sold his field because the famine was severe upon them. So the land became Pharaoh's. And as for the people, he moved them into the cities from one end of the borders of Egypt to the other end. Only the land of the priests did he not buy. For the priests had rations allotted to them by Pharaoh, and they ate their rations, which Pharaoh gave them. Therefore, they did not sell their lands. And Joseph said to the people, "Indeed, I have bought you and your land this day for Pharaoh. Look, here is seed for you, and you shall sow the land. And it shall come to pass in the harvest that you shall give one-fifth to Pharaoh. Four-fifths shall be your own, as seed for your field and for your food, for those of your households, and as food for your little ones." So they said, "You have saved our lives. Let us find favor in the sight of my lord, and we will be Pharaoh's servants." And Joseph made it a law over the land of Egypt to this day that Pharaoh should have one-fifth except for the land of the priests only, which did not become Pharaoh's. So Israel dwelt in the land of Egypt in the country of Goshen. And they had possessions there and grew and multiplied exceedingly. And Jacob lived in the land of Egypt 17 years. So the length of Jacob's life was 147 years. When the time drew near that Israel must die, he called his son Joseph and said to him, "Now if I have found favor in your sight, please put your hand under my thigh and deal kindly and truly with me. Please do not bury me in Egypt, but let me die with my fathers. You shall carry me out of Egypt and bury me in their burial place." And he said, "I will do as you have said." Then he said, "Swear to me." And he swore to him. So Israel bowed himself on the head of the bed. And of course, I remind you, Israel is another name for Jacob. And here we end the reading of God's word. And and may he bless it, and now the preaching of his word. What you see in this passage is first how Jacob blesses the foster father that God has provided to look after him and his family. And then you see secondly how the foster father has himself been provided for by God through Joseph, the son of Jacob, who is the savior of Egypt in a way, in this temporal salvation, providing bread for them in famine, and the savior of Israel as well. And finally, you see how Jacob once again shows that his foster father is not the eternal father. Okay, it's just a provisional father for the time being. So let's learn how we're to respond to the foster fathers that God has put over us as we look at this passage this morning. First, learn here something we looked at last week, that as God's people, we are to bless our foster fathers. See in verses 7 through 10 how Jacob blesses Pharaoh. It's mentioned twice in that short paragraph about Jacob's meeting with Pharaoh in order to emphasize what happened here. And as I explained to you in the introduction, it's very striking because this poor old wrinkled up shepherd, you see, who is dependent on Pharaoh for bread and for land, for his family to be able to live and not die, he is the one who blesses Pharaoh instead of the other way around, Pharaoh blessing him. It shows that although Pharaoh is the one that has bread, Jacob is the one who has access to the Lord, who provided the bread to Pharaoh in the first place, and who alone has the promise of eternal life. Both Pharaoh and Jacob, the encouraging thing is, both Pharaoh and Jacob seem to know this, to recognize this. God has made this clear to Pharaoh by his exposure to Joseph. God had raised up Joseph as a mercy to Pharaoh. And Joseph, of course, was Jacob's son. And he was a prophet who revealed to Pharaoh the things of God. And he told Pharaoh about the famine that was coming, the time of plenty and then the time of famine, interpretation of Pharaoh's dream. Without Joseph, Pharaoh would not have been in a position to be able to provide for Jacob and his family, to give them bread. And Pharaoh knows this. He knows that he was dependent upon the revelation of God, which he believed, and dependent upon the mediator that God had sent between him and his people. So foster fathers of God's people, you see, they do not always know that it is the Lord who has provided for them through the risen Savior that he has appointed. But whether they know that or not, he is the one who provides for them. The Lord Jesus Christ, who is raised up, is the one who provides for the nations, whether they recognize him or not. And in those nations, God's people live and flourish. The foster fathers of God's people many times don't recognize that it is he who gives them the power to get wealth. But this Pharaoh in Jacob's day seems to recognize that. Why do I say that? Because he lets Jacob bless him. He raises no objection to this. He knows that he needs the blessing that Jacob has from the Lord. And Jacob especially wants to bless Pharaoh because he knows that God has appointed Pharaoh to look after his family, which is the church in this day during the famine. His family's survival is dependent on Pharaoh being blessed by God. If Pharaoh is not blessed with bread, then he will not be able to provide for Israel as their foster father during this famine. So Jacob blesses the Egyptian Pharaoh with humble gratitude. He recognizes the kindness of this Pharaoh to his family, which is the family, again, from which the Messiah is to come. Jesus Christ, the Messiah, who will bring ultimate salvation to the nations of the earth. And Jacob also blesses Pharaoh because he wants Pharaoh to trust in that promise. He wants Pharaoh to know the much more important blessing of eternal life. Jacob knew, and hopefully Pharaoh also knew, that without that blessing, he might have all the bread in the world, and it would be to no avail. What will a man profit if he gains the whole world and loses his own soul? Jacob knows the promises of God, and he blesses Pharaoh with yearnings that Pharaoh might have eternal life. It is my hope that we might see this Pharaoh in heaven one day. And that should be our desire for the foster fathers that God has given us today, whoever they are. We should be like Jacob and bless them and yearn for their salvation. The Bible commands us again and again to seek the blessing of those who rule over us as our foster fathers that He has appointed over us. We are to love them. Even if there are enemies who are persecuting us, we are to pray for them. And not just for their worldly prosperity so that we can prosper under their care, but we're also to pray that God would bless them with His salvation in Jesus Christ, that they might come to know Him and love Him. They are our foster fathers, and it is our duty to love them and to pray for them, even if they are cruel and twisted and wicked. We're to seek their good and blessing. If you look at 1 Timothy 2, you can see how the Lord gives this instruction. I said it's all through the Bible. Well, this is one of the principal places where it's given very directly to us. 1 Timothy 2, 1, the apostle speaking for the Lord says, "Therefore I exhort, first of all, that supplications, prayers, intercessions, and giving of thanks be made for all men." All kinds of people. He says, for kings and for all who are in authority, that we may lead a quiet and peaceable life in all godliness and reverence. For this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men to be saved and to come to the knowledge of the truth. For there is one God and one mediator between God and men, the man Christ Jesus. You see how it is in part that we pray for blessing upon them, that we, the church, might flourish under their care, that we might lead a quiet and peaceable life under their government with all godliness and reverence, under a wise and prosperous government that they would exercise. So we pray for that kind of prosperity. But it also emphasizes that we're to pray that they would be saved, that they would come to a knowledge of truth, the eternal salvation that God has promised. God desires it all men, all kind of men, not just simple people, not just kings, but kings and all people, that they would be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth about Jesus, the only Savior, is the only way for them to be saved. God doesn't have one way for kings to be saved, one way for people in another, one nation to be saved, and another way for people in another nation. God has one mediator between God and man, the man Christ Jesus. And whether the rulers that are over us know Him or not, we are to seek that they would know Him and to pray for them, to pray earnestly before them for their salvation. As we yearn to see our leaders come to know Him, even if they seem far from the Lord, we're still to pray for them. When Paul wrote these words, Rome was the power at hand. The emperor of Rome wasn't a godly man. And he says, pray for kings. Pray that they will come to know the Lord. So it's God's will for you to bless those who rule over you as kings and rulers. You have access to God, and if they don't know Him, they don't have access to God. The God who not only prospers their kingdom, but who also gives eternal life. You're to pray for them, as Paul says, if you should be given the opportunity even to go and pray, you should even go and pray for them in person. It just occurred to me when I was studying this passage, just about a week ago, we had our MLA come by to visit. And that would have been a perfect opportunity for me to say, can I pray for you? And to pray for him as he leads, as he bears responsibility, to give thanks for him and the work that he's doing and be my behalf, the care that he extends to his people, the people that he's looking after, and to pray for his salvation. You see, that's the thing that we need to be doing. I have something that he has, that he desperately needs. I need his protection, government, help, all those things. He needs the salvation that I know through Jesus Christ. So I have something to be a blessing to him. And of course, you should also pray for others that God has put over you. as foster fathers, as it were, or leaders of any kind that God has given to care for you, even your own flesh and blood fathers and mothers. You pray for them and for their blessing and prosperity and for your employer. You know, why not go to your employer and say, may I pray for you? You know, you're running this company. You have a lot of responsibility. May I pray for you? Pray for his salvation. Now, you have to use wisdom. If it's someone that's hostile toward the gospel, you might not choose to do that. Pray for them in secret, though. Continue to pray for them and pour out effectual prayers. Now, I want to move on to the second thing that we're taught here about those that God has put over us as foster fathers. And the second point, we're not taught this time by the example of Jacob, but this time we're shown through Joseph how Jesus preserves our foster fathers in the world. Okay, Joseph preserves Egypt because Egypt is preserving us. You get the picture? That's what we see in this. So we look at the wisdom. Now, Joseph doesn't so much show the power as he represents Christ as an example to us here, but he shows the wisdom particularly that Christ exercises in the decisions that he makes. So the second thing then is that we admire the way our Lord governs our foster fathers. Know that Jesus has been given authority to govern the kings and kingdoms of this world for the benefit of the church. And that is exactly what he is doing right now as I speak. This is taught in Ephesians 1 that I read to you before. In verse 20, it says that God has raised him, Jesus, from the dead and seated him at his right hand in the heavenly places, far above all principality and power and might and dominion and every name that is named, not only in this age, but also in that which is to come. And then in verse 22, it says, and he put all things under his feet and gave him to be head over all to the church, which is his body, the fullness of him who fills all in all. Now, I hope it thrills your soul to hear that. I hope it gives you goosebumps to think about him being over all things, over all dominion and power and authority that's named in heaven and earth, now and forever. All things. He is the head of the church. He is the head over all things. Principalities, powers, thrones, dominions. Jesus is in the position. Do you see? Jesus is in the position that belongs only to the Most High God. No one else can have that kind of authority. Only he can have that authority. It's the position that Nebuchadnezzar, the king of Babylon, recognized belonged only to God when God humbled him. You know who Nebuchadnezzar was. He was the king of Babylon, that great king that had done great things. He was a very enterprising man. He had had great success in all of his campaigns. He'd conquered the whole world. He was very wise in his government. He'd brought the leaders from all the nations into his cabinet to advise him and serve him so that he befriended them, and then they led their people to follow him. It was a mighty kingdom. There was gold and silver and great buildings going on. He had authority to command someone to be, if there's someone that did something he didn't approve of, to kill that person and to lift that person up to a high position. Whatever he wanted to do, that was King Nebuchadnezzar. And he was very proud and he boasted and he said, look at this great Babylon that I have built. And he went on about it. And you know what happened to him in the days of Daniel? He was brought down and became like a beast that was crawling around in the dew and getting his hair all matted down, and his fingernails growing out long and everything. A very, very humbled position. He went out of his mind to humble him and bring him down. And after that, Nebuchadnezzar wrote a chapter in the Bible. This pagan king wrote a chapter in the Bible, and he testifies about the authority of God Most High, the authority that belongs only to God. In Daniel 4:34, he says, and at the end of the time, I, Nebuchadnezzar, lifted my eyes to heaven, and my understanding returned to me. Okay, he'd been out of his mind. And I blessed the Most High and praised and honored him who lives forever. For his dominion is an everlasting dominion, and his kingdom is from generation to generation. It's not like Nebuchadnezzar. He's going to die, right? He's not going to be around forever. His kingdom is from generation to generation. All the inhabitants of the earth are reputed as nothing. He can go like that and they're gone. He does according to his will in the army of heaven and among the inhabitants of earth. No one can restrain his hand or say to him, what have you done? You know, why did you do this? You can't question what he does. In the Old Testament, the Lord is pictured as the one who comes on the clouds in his chariot. He comes and he brings forth storms. He throws out lightning and thunderbolts, and he goes and moves nations and lifts up one kingdom, brings down another kingdom. He does whatever he pleases. It's a very glorious picture of him riding on the clouds. When Jesus was brought before the chief priests and elders, he claimed that they were going to see him doing that. What a powerful passage that is. Our Lord Jesus Christ standing there in our flesh and saying that he's going to come in the clouds and be the one who is administering that sovereign authority as the Son of Man over the entire earth and all the kingdoms. Listen to Mark 14, 61 through 64. He is on trial. He is put under oath. It says, again, the high priest asked him, saying to him, are you the Christ, the Son of the Blessed? Jesus said, I am. Now, he might have stopped there, mightn't he? But he goes on and he says, and you will see the Son of Man sitting at the right hand of power and coming with the clouds of heaven. He's in that exalted station. Then the high priest tore his clothes and said, what further need do we have of witnesses? You have heard the blasphemy. What do you think? They all condemned him to be deserving of death because he had claimed to have that place that belongs only to God Most High. Of course, Jesus Christ is God Most High. It belongs to him. But it belongs to him now as our risen mediator. This is the place that belongs only to deity. And Jesus, who walked around in our flesh, in this world, on this earth, is now in this flesh, exalted to sit in that throne, in that place that God has appointed for him. He did not give them... So we have Jesus then. He has power to raise up nations and to put down nations. And he constantly exercises that power, as Ephesians 1 tells us, for the sake of the church. Now, as we look at Joseph, we see how he governs Egypt for the sake of Israel. And again, Joseph gives us insight, not about the power so much. He had authority in Egypt, true, but about the wisdom is what we particularly see with which Christ governs. That's what we're shown here with the example of Joseph. So last week, we saw that even though Joseph had authority to give his brothers the highest seats in government, in wisdom, he did not do that. He did not give them such places because he knew that they would not be best for them. Instead, he gave them a good land where they could continue their work as shepherds and herdsmen. This work was not an honorable work in Egypt, as I already reviewed to you, but it was very beneficial for them to have their regular work to continue and to be in this humble place so that they would not mingle with the Egyptians but could raise up as an independent nation that would then fulfill the purposes of God. We admired how Joseph governed in this matter, and it led us to admire how Jesus governs us. Not always giving us. People say, well, if Jesus is reigning, why doesn't he give us all these things that we want? Because it would ruin us. That's why. Many times it's the lowly ones that are in the kingdom of God. The Bible tells us that. Not many wise, not many mighty, not many noble are called. That's the way he has appointed it. And some people that were noble and mighty are actually brought to a place of greater humiliation in the world. Let the rich be humbled, James says. So it's not a bad thing for us. It's a good thing for us. And now this week, we're shown more of wisdom, how Joseph not only governs Israel, but also Egypt for the sake of Israel. And he does it in two wonderful ways. Now, of course, Joseph does not do his governing by divine power in the secret place from heaven as Jesus Christ does. But he rather does it. But we see still his wisdom, again, as a reflection of the wisdom of Christ. So what do we see here? First, he governs them in such a way that they have bread in the famine. Now it's now 2 or 3 years into the famine, and we're told in verse 13 that there was no bread in all the land. For the famine was very severe, it says, so that the land of Egypt and the land of Canaan languished because of the famine. People were starving. And Israel would have starved too. I mean, this is like the pictures you see of people in famine. The children with the distended bellies and the skinny arms, and they're dying. People were dying because they had no food. And God provided bread for his people that they had to have to live. And the way he provided was through the wisdom of Joseph. It was to Joseph that God revealed the meaning of Pharaoh's dreams. And it was to Joseph that God showed that there would be 7 years of plenty and 7 years of famine. And it was to Joseph that God revealed what should be done in order that the land of Egypt would have bread to be sustained through the famine. This chapter shows us how Joseph had bread in Pharaoh's storehouses when everyone else was out of bread. It was because of the wisdom. God arranged it in this way. Yes, he arranged it so that Egypt could survive, but even more, he arranged it this way so that Israel could survive, because they were the nation that was to bring salvation to the earth. They were his people, and he had made solemn covenant promises to them that he would take care of them and preserve them, that they might be his people and that they might bless the nations and bring his blessing to the nations. Today, it is to all of those who are in the Church of Jesus Christ that God especially has his eye and care upon them. Secondly, Joseph governs Egypt at this time, not only in such a way that they have bread, but in such a way that Pharaoh is strengthened and all the great families in Egypt are weakened. Now, whether Joseph did this entirely deliberately, knowing what he was doing, or whether God guided him either secretly or through revelation, doesn't really matter. Joseph is here doing a very wise action that will prepare God's people for Egypt to be the blessing that it's supposed to be as a foster father to Israel. You can see who the you can see how the people of Egypt run out of bread in the first couple of years of the famine. Then, as we follow the narrative there, they run out of money in the next few years by buying bread from Joseph. They use up all their money. Then they transfer the ownership of their farm animals over to Pharaoh. They were probably still looking after the animals, but they now belong to Pharaoh in exchange for more bread. And then finally, in the last year, they sell their lands and they sell themselves as slaves to Pharaoh for bread. Now, it may seem cruel to us, but we need to understand that it did not seem cruel to the Egyptians at all. We tend to associate slavery with the kind of slavery where people come in and kidnap people and force them into slavery. But they volunteered for this slavery, and that was often done in the ancient world in times of distress. Verse 18 says, when that year had ended, they came to him, to Joseph, the next year and said to him, we will not hide from my Lord that our money is gone. My Lord, they refer to Joseph as my Lord because of his exalted position. They say, my Lord also has our herds of livestock. There is nothing left in the sight of my Lord but our bodies and our lands. Why should we die before your eyes, both we and our land? Buy us and our land for bread, and we and our land will be servants of Pharaoh. Give us seed that we may live and not die, that the land may not be desolate. Then Joseph bought all the land of Egypt for Pharaoh. For every man of the Egyptians sold his field because the famine was severe upon them. So the land became Pharaoh's. And Joseph doesn't oppress them at all in this situation. Knowing that the famine is over, when it's over, he sets them up as tenant farmers. And he only requires that they return 20%, one-fifth of their produce, and keep the remaining four-fifths for themselves. Now, this was in a day when we can look at some of the records in the world at this time, around this time period, and there are lots of rental rates that are certainly one-third. And there are ones that are even greater than that. There are ones that are half. And there's even some that are two-thirds, or where you had to give four-fifths. There are records that indicate that, the actually opposite, where you give 80% to the owner and you live off of the remaining 20%. And so these Egyptians were quite happy with these arrangements. They were in a position of vulnerability, but they're very happy. And really, these measures likely took a lot of Egyptians out of a place where they were lowly servants to some more powerful family and master, and made them tenant farmers. So there were lots of tenant farmers that had smaller plots of land that were all working around, and really a happier situation for many of the people than they had had before. So verse 25, it says, "So they said to Joseph, 'You have saved our lives. Let us find favor in the sight of my Lord, and we will be Pharaoh's servants.'" They're happy about what Joseph has done. But it seems that we're told about all this transference of power from the people to Pharaoh for a reason. That we're told about it in the context as it relates to God's care of Israel, his people. Because you see, the sovereign God was working in behalf of Israel when they were in Egypt. And these things were brought about for the sake of Israel. And it's presented to us that way. Look at verse 27. It shows it as a consequence. All of those things happened where they became servants to Pharaoh. And then verse 27 says, So therefore, in other words, Israel dwelt in the land of Egypt in the country of Goshen. And they had possessions there and grew and multiplied exceedingly. Beautiful years of prosperity followed for Israel after the famine, so that they multiplied as God had promised. And it seems that the way that Joseph governed Egypt had something to do with that. The way that he governed during the famine somehow contributed to the fact that Israel prospered as they did. Not only were they were given bread, of course, so that they didn't die, but also the way that he transferred power from the people to Pharaoh. What might this have done? What did this mean for them? Well, this meant that Pharaoh had authority to set Israel up in Goshen without anyone coming to oppose him. You see, if there had been great families in Egypt, they might have opposed this. Say, who are these people that are moving into our land? Who are these people that are giving the best land in Goshen? But the great families in Egypt had been weakened. So they were in no position to rise up against Jacob's family as they might have done if there were no famine and have skirmishes and little battles and things. Israel was able to live in peace and quietness. They were able to prosper and grow without anyone molesting them under the favor of their foster father, Pharaoh, the king of Egypt. And that is it not also that all this transfer of power that Pharaoh accomplished as far as God's purposes for Israel, it also meant that in future years, when another Pharaoh arose who did not know Joseph, that Pharaoh was in such a position of power and authority that he could oppress Israel. And no one could stop him. So, well, that doesn't sound very good. But it was good. It was what God had planned for his people. See, the Lord tells that wicked Pharaoh that comes along later, he tells that Pharaoh himself that he raised him up on purpose in order to make his power known to his people who didn't know his power very well. And so we could know God's power. So all the earth could know God's power because of what he did in Egypt with Israel. God deliberately gave Pharaoh great power, so that nobody on earth could challenge him and nobody on earth could stop him, so that the Lord could reveal to his people that he was Lord and he could stop Pharaoh. If Pharaoh had been weak, no one would have been impressed when Moses goes in and says, "Let my people go." And Pharaoh lets the people go against his will. You see, God revealed. He said, "I'm doing this in order that I might," God said, "I'm doing this in order that I might make my power known. I have raised you up, Pharaoh, in order that this might be done." And right here with Joseph, we see how Pharaoh was raised up and given great authority. And he was a good Pharaoh at that time. He blessed God's people and cared for them and provided for them in the time when they were in the incubation period. They were growing, multiplying. And then when they became a great nation, another Pharaoh comes and oppresses them, because that was exactly what God had purposed to be done. So the Lord knew what he was doing when he gave Pharaoh such power. In the earlier years, Then the Pharaoh is used to protect. In the later years, the threads of God's sovereignty come together to raise up that Pharaoh. So what do we learn from this passage then? We learn that our Lord Jesus, who has all authority to govern the nations, governs them for the sake of the church. We can be confident that when rulers are raised up, no matter what kind of rulers they are, our wise Lord has raised them up for the sake of the church. We do not need to be afraid. Even if the mountains are cast into the sea, we have no need to fear. Our mighty Savior, who is over all things for the church, is reigning. He will accomplish what he has purposed, and not one promise will fail. He will reign in such a way that he graciously teaches us and guides us and chastens us and shapes us so that we might be the people that he's called us to be. And all the while, it is our duty to pray for those who govern us, to pray and to seek God's salvation for them, to pray and labor that we might be a blessing among them, and to thank God for them as foster fathers whom God has given us until we go to be with him in glory. We are flourishing under them just as Israel flourished in Egypt, not only when Israel was multiplying and at peace, but also when they were in slavery and opposed. They were flourishing according to God's purpose, and only until God would deliver them in the end. And that calls to mind the third thing that I want to show you from this passage. Thirdly, see here how important it is to remember that our foster fathers are only provisional fathers. Jacob gives strong testimony to this fact to his sons that Egypt is not their final resting place and that Pharaoh is only a temporary foster father. He makes Joseph solemnly swear that he will bury him in the land of Canaan. You see that in verse 29 through 31. When the time drew near that Israel must die, he called his son Joseph and said to him, "Now if I have found favor in your sight, please put your hand under my thigh and deal kindly and truly with me. Please do not bury me in Egypt, but let me lie with my fathers. You shall carry me out of Egypt and bury me in their burial place." And he said, "I will do as you have said." Then he, Jacob, said, "Swear to me." And he, Joseph, swore to him. So Jacob does not do this because of mere sentiment or superstition. He does it because of the promises of God to him and his fathers. He doesn't want to be buried in Egypt because Egypt is just the place that where Israel is supposed to multiply. It's not their final resting place. They're only to be there for a while. Egypt is the place where they multiply, but Canaan is the place where God is to establish his kingdom and bring the Messiah. By being buried there, Jacob's sons would be reminded of the promise over the next generations while they were in Egypt and conditions worsened. God had already revealed that they would be brought into bondage in Egypt. They already knew that that was going to happen in the future, and then he would deliver them. And they needed a promise to sustain them that God had plans for them, that he was going to deliver them. Their father's bones was there in Canaan. And it reminded them that God was going to bring them there. Jacob then gives testimony of his hope in the promises of God by asking to be buried there. Now you might ask, how would such a promise help if you were one of the generations that lived and died in Egypt? What good is it to you if two generations from now they get delivered from this terrible bondage and you live and die there for 70 years? It would help in the same way that it helped Jacob. How did it help Jacob? How did the promise help Jacob? Jacob didn't get the land either. Jacob died in Egypt. But he had a promise that God was going to raise him up, that God was going to give it to him. Abraham didn't get the land. Isaac didn't get the land. Jacob didn't give the land. But they got the promise. And they believed that God would raise them up and he would give them that land. They sought for a city whose builder and maker is God. And they're waiting still. It wasn't when Israel came into Egypt. God didn't raise up Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob when Israel went into Canaan out of Egypt. No, that was just a preparatory thing too. They're still waiting for the resurrection at the last day, just like we are. And then they'll be raised up. And they'll be given that inheritance that they sought all their life. They confessed when they were here that they were only pilgrims and strangers. They knew that they were just passing through. And Jacob is saying that about Egypt now to his sons. This is just a temporary thing. Pharaoh is just your foster father. Take my bones to Canaan. That's where I'm going to be raised up at the last day. That's where the promise of God is going to be fulfilled when he returns in the end. Now, Jacob didn't have all of that worked out because it hadn't all been revealed, but he knew that there is a city whose builder and maker was God, eternal in the heavens. And that was where his hope is. Jacob knew that all the years until the final resurrection at the last day were years of preparation of that city for what God has for it. Right now, brothers and sisters, you are being prepared. The Church of Jesus Christ around the world is being prepared for that last day. This isn't it. This isn't the final resting place. The final resting place is the eternal glory. The lesson that ought to come to you, dear brothers and sisters, with even more forcefulness than it came to Jacob's sons, is that God gives us our place in the world, often under rulers who serve as our foster fathers. We're thankful for them. We're thankful for the church and how Christ has provided for the church, that we grow and we multiply here. But we have even more reason to be thankful because we have seen even more of God's wonderful plan that is leading to that final place that he has called us. We have seen how God did bring Israel out of Egypt with a mighty hand and an outstretched arm and showed that he was Lord. And we have seen how he established them as his people and how he gave them laws and set up worship and showed more clearly than ever before that he would provide a sacrifice to take away their sin. When he gave them the laws of love, we see what it's going to be like in heaven, where we will love one another the way Jesus has loved us. And the sacrifice that showed to them what was going to be done to atone for their sins. And we, brothers and sisters, we who live now have seen, thanks be to God, the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ. And him being the Lamb of God who was crucified to take away the sin of the world. And we have seen how in our flesh, having borne our sin, he was raised to sit in that divine place of power that we talked about this morning, where he promises to reign until he has put all of his enemies under his feet. And we have seen how the blessing has, according to his promise, spread to all nations. And most of all, and most all of us are from those nations that were once cut off from God, but that have now been made near by the blood of Christ and joined to Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob to wait for the resurrection at the last day and the promise of heaven. Of all people living in these days, we should not be afraid. Of all people, we should be confident that our Lord Jesus Christ is reigning over all for us and that he will not fail to accomplish one promise. Let us lay down our lives for him. Let us abandon ourselves. Let us die for him that we may live with him. Let us put away our pride and our selfishness and start loving one another as he has loved us and given himself for us. And above all, let us love him who is reigning and risen for us at God's right hand until the kingdoms of the world become the kingdoms of our Christ. Then we will be brought to our final rest. Then we will see him whom our soul loves, and we will love him more than we have ever loved him before. Please stand and let's ask him. Let's compel the Lord to do this for us. Gracious Heavenly Father, we pray that your kingdom would come, that your will would be done on earth as it is in heaven. It is not done today. It is not done in the church, Father. We are people who are full of sin and corruption. And we praise you that the day is coming when your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. And when we will be in heaven, when the new heavens and the new earth, when this earth will be in your presence, and no longer will we be estranged from you as we have been by the fall. We thank you that our Lord Jesus is reigning and that he is bringing about your purposes that you have promised. We thank you, Lord, that we are buried in hope of the resurrection, that this is not our inheritance, that what we have now is not the final inheritance. It never will be until the day that Jesus Christ returns. That will be our final resting place. There is a rest that remains for the people of God. And Heavenly Father, we long for that rest. And we pray that you would hasten the coming of our Lord Jesus Christ, and that we would be able to rejoice to see him in all of his glory and majesty, with the angels surrounding him and the praises of heaven and exalting his name and glorifying him, that we may join in that chorus, that we may be able to praise him and exalt him who lives forever and ever. And that in him, Lord, we may live forever and ever in peace and prosperity, in blessing, and in the fullness of all that you have for us. Father, change these corrupt and vile bodies and make them like his risen glorious body. We pray, Father, that you would abolish death and tears, and that you would bring all of these promises, and that you would change us, Lord. You have promised that when we see him, we will be like him because we will see him as he is. Father, we pray for that day. We desire to be able to love people. We don't love people now, and we desire to be able to do so, that all this selfishness that is in us, all this pride and corruption that keeps us from knowing you and seeing you, that it would be taken away from us, Lord, and that we would be able to stand before you, Lord, in pure and holy love, delighting in your glory, no longer blinded by all of our corruption, but able to see you as you are. Father, how we yearn for the things that you have promised to us. Father, thank you for the care that you have now and the foster fathers that you have placed over us to preserve us, to work in us, and to keep us until that day. We pray these things in Jesus' name. Amen.